We come to the house of God. This is a celebratory time. This is a time of celebration. When we come in this morning, and we sing a song like "How Beautiful Heaven Must Be." Man, I'm telling you, it ought to get something moving inside of our heart, or something should have already been moving to where we might be able to move somebody else that's not moving so good. Amen. Listen, friend, when we sing those blood songs, if we really believe the life of the flesh is in the blood thereof, and then praise God, there's something that begins to stir in our heart, and something to stir in the depths of our soul, and we are saved, filled with the Spirit, and full of Spirit. Amen.
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 I'm sick and tired of dead churchianity.
Yeah.
I'm sick and tired of dead Christians.
Yeah.
I don't like funeral homes. I don't like graveyards.
Amen.
I detest them. I don't like hospitals. I don't like doctor's offices.
Amen.
Don't like those places. Amen. Why? Because of what the association is with all of those things. Listen, friend. Live every day because you have hope. This word actuated as the Bible, or as the definition, to live means to be inwardly quickened, nourished, and actuated by divine influence or faith. Actuated means to be put in action, inciting in action. Listen, God put His life in you. If you're saved this morning, then you have Jesus Christ, the hope of glory in you. Amen. Hey, friend, I'm going to tell you, there ain't no mourning going on in glory.
Yeah.
Friend, I'm telling you, as God looks down upon the face of this planet and sees the condition that He's in or it's in, I'm telling you, friend, it's not got Him in such a state that He's had to take half a baby aspirin to get over it. Amen. He's still just as excited about things as He ever has been, and His Spirit lives and abides in you, and you ought to live every day because you've got hope. You ought to live vigorously. Amen. You ought to be enjoying the ride. Praise God.
Amen.
Now, you know one of the greatest problems of Christ's day came from one of His greatest adversaries. Now, y'all ready for this? One of His greatest adversaries and one of the greatest enemies still of the church today was the Pharisees.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
All of the extra legislation that they put on the law had people so bound down that they couldn't enjoy life.
Right.
I look at some of you this morning, friend. I realize that's your problem. You can't enjoy life because you've listened too much to the Pharisee, and you're trying to follow the life of the Pharisee instead of allowing God to live in you and enjoy this thing. Amen. God did not save you to bind you up and to bound you down. God saved you, friend. The Bible said, "And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free." It didn't say it would bind you up with all kinds of added extras, just like the traditions of our forefathers. Listen, in the fundamentalist movement and in the independent Baptist movement across this country for years, they've been just like the Pharisees between Malachi and Matthew. They've come up with all their can-dos and can-nots. Scripture, amen. And Christians today are not enjoying this thing because they're trying to please man instead of trying to please God. You know why I'm enjoying this thing this morning? I could absolutely care less about what the brethren thinks. I'm not interested in what tradition teaches. Thank God I'm enjoying the trip because I believe the book. I believe the scholar. I believe the Scripture, amen. And thank God when I'm in line with the Scripture, then the Spirit of God's filling my soul, and I'm enjoying the ride, amen.
Amen.
Amen,
amen, preacher.
Amen.
It's hard. It's hard to be animated. It's hard to enjoy the trip, friend, when you're all bound down with legalities.
Yeah.
Amen.
Hello.
Amen.
For years, we've taking everything away from God's children and not giving them anything back.
Yeah,
man.
You can't do this. You can't do that. You certainly can't do this. And boy, I'm telling you, man, you're going to be really putting yourself in a pickle with God if you do that.
Amen.
Don't give me what your father said. Don't give me what grandpa said. Don't give me what some other fundamentalist said. Don't give me what you got out of a commentary. Bless God, give me what you got out of a book. And if the book condemns and calls it sin, okay. It's sin, but if it don't, bless God. And God's pleased with it. And you need to learn how to live in these last days. Amen.
I'm enjoying the truth.
That's right.
There's just something about being free. God set me free in the spring of 1969. And thank God, you know, I told you the other night about running from the Lord all those years. I'm telling you, since the fall of 1981, friend, I went through that little period and I followed after. Some of those Pharisees, when I first started preaching, and friend, I became one of those real mean legalistic preachers and thought, friend, that if it wasn't sin, that I could condemn it as sin. I've been down that road, friend. I just brought a lot of heartache into my heart. Brought a lot of heartache into my home. My friend caused a lot of confusion in congregations that I preached in years ago. One day, thank God, the Holy Ghost finally got my attention. And I realized, friend, it isn't what the brother thinks. Hallelujah to God. It's what God the Father thinks. Amen.
Amen.
I'm enjoying this thing.
Amen.
Some of y'all need to lighten up.
Amen.
You need to begin to live and enjoy this thing.
Yes,
yeah. Amen. Man, free. Free, I told you this before, I'm going to tell you, get right here. One of the freedoms that I enjoy, and one of the freedoms that I like getting out on that Yamaha, friend, and on about a 74 degree day, and get out on the interstate, maybe going from here towards Statesville, and friend, set that cruise control on 75, and turn on some good music, friend, kick my feet up on them highway pegs, and just enjoy the ride, amen, and let the Holy Ghost of God. Well, there's just something about the wind hitting you in the face. Amen. If you've never been there, you don't understand. Some of you guys used to ride in the back of them pickup trucks. You felt that freedom. You wasn't in the cab. You was in the back. You could feel that wind hitting you in the face. And you thought, man, this is life. Well, let me tell you, how when you get that freedom and that wind of the Holy Ghost gets to hit you in the face, how you'll know what it is to enjoy life. Amen. I went through that phase where everything in the world was sin. Everything's not sin.
Right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Everything in the world is not sin.
Right.
And I believe, listen, I believe if you're going to enjoy life, you need to be a fanatic about it.
Amen.
A fanatic is a fan that enjoys going to the extremes. Hello?
Yeah.
I mean, look, if you enjoy watching a football game, then you ought to enjoy being an armchair coach. Or you ought to enjoy being an armchair quarterback. Or you ought to enjoy being an armchair running back. Or if nothing else, bless God, you ought to enjoy being a living room cheerleader. And every once in a while, you ought to get excited. Amen? I know Amanda, you know, she refs soccer. I never have got into soccer. You know, they call it football. I call it boring. But if you like soccer and you go to a soccer game, you ought to be a fan.
Yeah.
You ought to be a fanatic about it. You ought to know whose side you're on.
Amen.
Yeah.
If you like basketball, hey, friend, listen, I've told you this before. My favorite basketball team is the Harlem Globetrotters. Some of the rest I absolutely care less about, man. And you know, I've noticed in 19 years of being pastor here, every time the Globetrotters come and they're over here at the Civic Center, it's either on a Sunday or it's on a Wednesday where I can't go. But if I really wanted to go watch somebody, Junior, I'd like to go watch the Harlem Globetrotters. I like all that crazy stuff that they do.
Amen.
Amen. I like the way they mess with the other team. I like the way they mess with the audience. Amen. I've always envisioned if I could ever go, and friend, they wanted to mess with somebody in the audience, they couldn't pick nobody out any better than me. Amen. Because I can dish it out just as much as they can and enjoy it. Amen. Amen. some of y'all need to lighten up, man. Y'all so miserable in your life, it's pathetic. You come in here on Wednesday night, you look like a whoop dog. All wet around the ears. And dear God, you think you've been scratching fleas all day long. And you've got so many ticks that they've just about drawn the last drop of blood. Amen. And life is just gone. Hey, friend, I know what's on the outside, but thank God, I'm not looking to what's on the outside. This world is not my home. I'm just passing through. Thank God I'm a pilgrim. And a pilgrim is somebody that's passing away. We're passing through on their way home. Amen.
Yep.
And that's all I am. I'm just on a pilgrimage down here. And thank God through these days, that trumpet's going to sound. And my pilgrimage is going to be over. And I'm going to be home with God. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all need to lighten up and enjoy the trip.
That's right. Yeah. Amen.
Amen. I mean, y'all, some of y'all got such burdens that you're carrying around that God never intended for you to carry around.
Plus some more.
Hello? Hello? I used to like to go four-wheeling when I didn't have a four-wheeler. When I didn't have a four-wheel drive, that 67 Chevrolet pickup truck I had that my grandfather bought new, I bought me some 10-inch wheels for the back of that brother Mike, and I got me some big old mudders and put on it. And I decided that, man, as long as you hit the water hole and the mud hole fast enough, and you kept the pedal to the metal, and as long as they was doing that fish tail, just like a prop behind of a boat, I knew I could get from point A to point B. The problem with them guys, them four-wheel drives, when we was down there in Flat Florida, is they try to just ease into that hole, and they'd get out there in the middle of it, and they'd sink, and they'd have to have somebody pull them out. You'd ask my wife, I picked her up, she was working in a grocery store, as a cashier, and I picked her up one day, and when she walked out the door, Brother Tate, she looked at my truck, and thought she was going to pass out. The only thing you could see on that red and white 67 Chevrolet was where my windshield wipers went back and forth, and she got in, and she said, where in the world have you been? I said, baby, I just hold on, I'm fixing to show you, amen. Amen. We went down where the favorite four-wheeling hole is at. And then I knew when you come around the curve, I knew how long and how deep the hole was. And I knew, Brother Tate, when I hit it, man, we needed to be moving. Praise God. Because there wasn't nobody there to pull me out. And everybody thought how stupid and dumb I was to try not to two-wheel drive anyway. Amen. I'm telling you, friend, boy, we hit it. And she screamed to the top of her lungs. And I know what she's thinking. We're going to get stuck out in the middle of this hole. And water's going to start coming in under the doors. Oh, absolutely not, friend. Man, we had ourselves a time. Praise God. And then some of them guys in four-wheel drive trucks showed up. They couldn't believe what I was out there doing. Amen. Because time and time and time again, they've been stuck. Now listen, friend. If I was still in that mode of action, I'd take one of them trucks and I'd build me a mud truck. Amen. I don't say this to be mean and ugly. I wouldn't spend the money on a Jeep that you spent on that Jeep and not find me a mud hole, bless God, to get it out of him and make sure it get me from point A to point B. Amen. Hey, don't build something just for looks. Amen. There ain't no fun just standing back and say, well, look what I've got. Then somebody says, well,